I was born the 22nd of December 1928 in Germany, where my father had spent some years as a junior research scholar in crystallography and geology. We then lived for a few years in the United States, where I spent my early childhood until the family returned home to Norway in the winter of 1936. So I started elementary school, second grade in Norway, and I've gone through my whole primary and secondary education in Norwegian school. My father was a shy and very self-disciplined person. My mother was impulsive and loving. But my real Garden of Eden was my grandparents, where we spent the summers and where I had a series of very happy periods. Though my father was a hard science geologist, he was also a broader kind of naturalist, and I used to accompany him in the summer when he was doing geological mapping. And I think that's how my interests in science and natural history developed. In school, I was a relatively bright pupil, but I was too scatterbrained to get really good grades there. And while at school, I continued also to have other interests outside, particularly for 2 or 3 years, I was a part-time apprentice to a Norwegian sculptor. And the idea of art was one option for my future. My teens were spent in Norway during 5 years of German occupation, and that, of course, dominated my life in those years. For about half a year, I lived with a family in a farm close to the Swedish border in case my family, my parents, would have to escape to Sweden. But that passed over and I returned to Oslo. I graduated from high school in 1946, and that was a moment when my father was invited as a visiting professor to the University of Chicago. So I went along with him and had this immense intellectual adventure of the world opening up. Chicago at that time was really, really fantastic. The faculty was brilliant. It was really an optimal academic environment for me.
Whilst in Chicago, Fredrik Barth wrote frequently to his friends in Oslo about what a good time he was having. His greatest discovery was the realization that he wanted to become an anthropologist. Quite often, he added drawings to his letters. This one is a visual expression of his undergraduate view of a typical anthropologist.
Ja, tusen takk, og takk for oppmøtet. Jeg håper da at dere ikke blir skuffet, og at det viser seg å være nyttig for dere for flere formål dette. Jeg skulle finne på en titel, og jeg må tilstå at det hovedsakelig fordi at disse filmfolkene vil ha et 34 sekunders klipp av meg som foreleser. Men straffen jo at jeg må snakke en hel forelesningsøkt for at de skal få det korte klippet. Og da måtte jeg finne på en titel også, og det jeg tenkte var at etnisitet og identitet, det stadig utfordringer i vårt fag, og det et felt hvor det sies mye tull fortsatt. Etnisitet, som dere vet alt for godt, et gammelt Bergens prosjekt, fra for 30 år siden. Det viktigste var at vi sa at etnisitet dreier seg om sosial organisasjon, og ikke om kultur. De enheter som vi refererer til med ord som etnisitet og etnisk gruppe, det sosiale grupper og kategorier. Det ikke kulturtradisjoner og kulturstoff i pakker. Men å fremstille det som at det var en serie lukkede pakker med kultur som skulle overføres fra foreldre til barn og som identifiserte etniske fellesskap og befolkninger. Det så fortegnende for alt som skjer, at det veldig vesentlig at antropologer ser det klart, argumenterer det klart og dokumenterer det så rikt de kan. Derimot så har vi da det andre titelbegrepet, identitet. Og der vi enda verre ute å kjøre enn slik som mange i dag bruker etnisitet. Identitet et veldig vanskelig og mangetydig ord. Det et sånt gummiord som du kan strekke og få til å passe på det du har lyst til å snakke om. Men det ikke sikkert at de som leser og hører deg forstår hva det du refererer til. Og du selv vil også, når du resonerer med begrepet identitet, så vil du være uklar, og så vil du egentlig ha snakket om det i en forstand, og så vil du resonere som om det hadde med disse andre sidene, og du vil fort ende opp i myra hvis du ikke holder tunga rett i munnen. Men for det annet så vår antropologiske analyse, den kan ikke fremmes ved at vi har et ord og bruker det som en benevnelse for det som vi vil studere, og ikke noe annet. Hvis jeg interessert i disse moderne livssituasjonene, så må jeg ikke gi dem et eget navn. Jeg skal tvert imot lete efter et ord som tvinger meg til å se dem i en komparativ sammenheng med andre menneskers livssituasjoner, og hvordan denne sektor av bevissthet organiseres hos dem. Hvis jeg gir et nytt navn på hvert nytt fenomen jeg ser, så får jeg aldri en generaliserende vitenskap. Men vi må gå ut og lære om det, og vi må bringe det inn i dette komparative perspektivet, og da kan vi kanskje gjøre noe. Det var storyen i dag. Gå og gjør det, så kan dere gjøre noe virkelig stort i antropologi, og noe veldig interessant om mennesker. Så god fornøyelse.
When Barth moved to Bergen in 1961, he was invited to set up a new social anthropology department in what for Norway was a brand new discipline. He had a free hand, recruited bright people, and within a few years, a department emerged which was to become well respected. Barth even may hold some kind of world record for the number of places he's done fieldwork. 8 societies at last count. Whilst in Bergen, he strongly promoted the idea that the way to develop theory was through field experience and not from joining schools of thought. That's why he likes fieldwork, and that's why he is devoted to the comparative method. The more fieldwork you do, he insists, the greater the scope for comparison. The topic of his second fieldwork in 1954 was about political leadership. So what drew him to work in Swat, Pakistan?
Several things, I guess, but mainly the idea that here is a zone in the northwest frontier province of Pakistan where tribal people have had relatively little interference from state government. They were sort of making their own political system. And I saw that as a focus of my study. What are the sources of power where you don't have a state machinery to back you up? On the one hand, I did want to study the sources of political power without a state apparatus. And I, as I say, I worked in part with people outside of the state, but most of my work was within the state. And the material is what was happening there and then. I guess the point is that the Wali rode the tiger. Mm-hmm. He had no way of controlling the state. He could only maintain his position by playing the two factions, which was essentially like other big chiefs had been playing the system always. So I could look at the lower level and see there an image of how indeed it had been 10 and 20 years earlier.
you went to some lengths to publish, to revisit SWAT, and to publish at length your own final position, as it were, on SWAT and your critics, who were more than Assad, there were others. You clearly were concerned to set the record straight as you saw it.
What Talal didn't understand was the absence of any sort of framework of security for anyone. He seems to represent it as if the rich men, the leaders, the landowners, were de facto powerful because they owned land. Mm-hmm. And the deepest core of my argument is that it doesn't work that way, because you only own land if you can defend it. Mm-hmm. The source is political, not economic. Economics and land control is the means by which you perpetuate, yes, and you are born into a class where this is possible, mm-hmm. but nobody gives you the land. You have to defend it yourself against your brothers, against your cousins, against everybody. So a class analysis unifies a level of landowners which is a figment of the class analysis.
Your work in SWAT led to a number of other essays apart from the political leadership book, and some of that work is the work for which you're best known today, work on the relationship between ethnic identity, ecological zones, and porous boundaries. Can you say more about how working in SWAT started you thinking about those things?
Yes. It started by me seeing in the bazaars in SWAT these strange people out of the mountains. Very sort of extraordinary figures. They didn't have shoes and boots. They had skins wrapped around their legs. They had long hair and big beards. And they were known among SWAT people as Kohistanis, people of the mountains. And I became curious about these people. And then as a sort of a break in my fieldwork in SWAT, I thought, why don't I go up there and look? Mm. And so I made you could call it an expedition, through a part of Kohistan. Rather uniquely at that time in history, I even entered some small valleys where no Westerner had ever been before. Because this was very wild country that the Wali of Swat had conquered in the late 40s, 10 years previously, and it had simply been closed till then. So I went up among them, and I saw a diversity of people, and some with overlapping distributions, and I saw this extraordinarily sharp difference between Patan settlement and Kohistani settlement. Mm. And yet I discovered among Kohistanis families who said, my grandfather was Patan, or we came from, or these stories. So I became fascinated with the theme of boundaries, cultural boundaries.
For 8 months, from 1957 to 1958, Barth did research among the Basari, pastoral nomads of South Persia. At a time when Middle Eastern governments were trying to get their nomad citizens to settle, Barth started thinking about what specific features led a few nomads to settle, but many others to continue as they were. The idea of generative processes came to influence later workers on pastoralism and sedentarization.
You've said to us that the period among the Basari was in certain ways your most enjoyable of your many fieldwork periods. Now, what made it so enjoyable?
The combination of being in this really extraordinarily beautiful landscape, together with large herds of animals, and particularly sheep. They are very innocent and very lovely animals. And then the other part of it was the Basri themselves, who were such gentle people in many ways, and artistic, poetic, romantic. And then being in that landscape, the southern Zagros Mountains are quite dramatic mountains, but wide open in an environment of stunning beauty. And to move through that with the animal herds, living close to the animals, helping at the birth of the lambs. The first couple of days we would carry the lambs because they couldn't move on migration. And we'd hang them over our neck, you know, karakuli lambskin and a warm beating heart against your neck as you rode with this thing slung over your shoulders. There were a lot of joys like that, simply in being with them.
What, in your view, switching back to the theoretical implications of the work, what, in your view, were the major achievements of your work on the Basri?
I would think that it was the depiction of the set of balances through which a pastoral adaptation becomes possible. There is the Malthusian problem, that population and herds and so on grow. And the pastures have a limited carrying capacity. Now, it was obvious that if people go hungry, they slaughter their animals, and then they eliminate the possibility of a pastoral adaptation. So I saw it as a logical puzzle. How does this work? And I think my account of it through sedentarization of impoverished people and sedentarization of rich people, mm-hmm. and a balance achieved then through a fluctuating animal population with disease and so on. Malthusian controls working on the animal population, mm-hmm. and economic controls leading to the shedding of the human population. And the combination of those two make sort of the basic ecological story of that monograph.
So that's an early development of your interest in generative processes and in specifying relationships between a fixed number of variables, I would have thought. I've often also wondered whether you attempted to use the insights from SWOT and the Basri to take an analytic look at EP's segmentary lineage systems model. I mean, yeah. Evans-Pritchard was still an influence in the 50s, but you could have broken a lance on him.
I could have, yes. But I had a sense that that would be petty and that I didn't know enough about the Sudan and the Nuer, and that I was using intellectual models that he had indeed created. I was using them in a different place and as part of my arsenal of models, and it didn't seem appropriate to use that occasion as a sort of a flat-out attack. I saw it as more important to polemically or dialectically to develop the idea of agency in contrast to structuralism, rather than locate my debate with EP on the level of lineage and segmentation.
After building up a department in Bergen, Barth decided in 1974 to return to Oslo, where he'd once been a research student whose work had not found favor. Now he could return with a solid reputation to a senior post.
Fredrik, you'd been teaching in Oslo for a few years, and then in 61 you moved to Bergen. Was there any anthropology there?
No, there wasn't really, and there hardly was in Oslo. But Bergen was a new university, and they wanted to try some new things, to do something that would be their own, and they gave me the chance. It was very unexpected and really, really very delightful. You can imagine your own country, suddenly you are asked to create a new discipline. Essentially, that's what it was. And it was such a challenge in so many directions. I had to think of what would be a good curriculum, what would be the best curriculum, what would be the focus of the discipline, what should be its breadth, what kind of professional cadre should we train? How could they serve Norwegian society and Norwegian academia? All these things come up at once and without precedent and without anyone to limit you. So my own imagination and conception was the only effective limitation. We were all of us amateurs. It was the first time for all of us. And the actual numbers were very small. But it became an exciting and stimulating environment, I think, for everyone who took part. And in the course of a few years, we built up a department in Bergen that even you people in England noticed, and that had its own character because we were given this sort of open field to develop. One of the things that I thought would be important was to work within Norway, not only in exotic areas. So I launched a project studying Norwegian fisheries, and a couple of colleagues and I together did this symposium on entrepreneurship and the way Norway was changing and what were the micro processes of that. And these gave really a theoretical reorientation that meant a lot to us too. So everything was happening at once.
Now, you stayed at Bergen for a number of years.
12 years.
12
yes.
years, and built up an internationally well-known department. Then you moved back to Oslo. What sort of a move was that?
Well, the immediate reason was that the old professor of ethnography in Oslo retired. But I'd always thought of my life as being one where I would return to Oslo. I am from Oslo, and that's sort of where I belong. So it was mainly the personal reason that was my real home. And I was a kind of a stranger in Bergen in the West. I could continue my professional career in Oslo with less responsibility, and I could sort of leave my creation in Bergen to successors who could take over.
And you had ongoing intellectual work that you'd started from Bergen that you needed to complete.
Right, I took all that with me. I had done fieldwork in New Guinea, and I was working on that analysis, and that was uninterrupted by the move.
Du har engang sagt, at dine forældre var meget forskellige som personer. Altså, din far var lidt streng og disciplinær, og din mor var sådan mere mild og humoristisk, men også sådan lidt ængstelig og bekymret. Hvordan har det haft noget sådan indflydelse på dit virke som antropolog og på dit liv?
Det har det vel på en indirekte måte ved, at jeg lærte, hvor forskellige folk kan forholde sig til livet. Min far hadde en voldsom selvdisciplin. Han var ikke disiplinær overfor meg, så han ga meg i grunnen frihet på samme måte og med samme generositet som min mor. Men hun var engstelig og spontan, og han viste meg som rollemodell, var han veldig annerledes, ja. Med en stor arbeidskraft, stor energi, veldig skarpt og krevende intellekt. Så ja, de var svært ulike personer.
Mm. Noget om, at i grundskolen, da du gik i grundskolen, der kunne du måske godt have fået nogle bedre karakterer, hvis du havde bestræbt dig på at følge lidt mere med.
Jeg har været en slags sådan oppositionel, ikke systematisk oppositionel, men at jeg likte ikke disciplin, og jeg likte ikke at gøre det, man skulle gøre. Jeg ville hellere gøre andre ting. Og i klassen, i skoletimene, tenkte jeg på andre ting. Og jeg hadde interesser, så jeg leste mye. Men for eksempel mitt yndlingsemne var jo zoologi. Men jeg fikk dårlige karakterer i naturfag alltid. For jeg leste ikke leksen, jeg kunne alt andre i stedet for. Og sånn. Så litt rotet og udisciplinert og perifer til mainstream.
Senere hen i livet, så afleverede du en PhD-opgave i Oslo, som blev afvist. Men det gav du ikke op. Du gav ikke op. Du fortsatte alligevel, fik den jo selvfølgelig godkendt i Cambridge. Hvordan ser du nu tilbage på den episode?
Det virket jo veldig truende for min karriere da. Det var knusende på en måte. Men nei, det stoppet meg ikke. For jeg har nok alltid vært veldig optimistisk. Jeg tror at det går. Og samme hva som skjer, så vil det sikkert kunne liksom sortere seg ut. Så det jeg gjorde med en gang da, var å erkjenne at her gjelder det å ikke la seg stoppe. Og på en måte var det jo en velsignelse ved at det brakte meg ut i det britiske miljøet. Hvis jeg hadde fått min doktorgrad her i Norge, så ville jeg ha vært mer provinsiell. Jeg ble tvunget til å gjøre det i det store ledende miljøet i stedet for. Mm. Og jeg fikk et nettverk av venner og kolleger og lærere som betød voldsomt mye for meg, og som jeg så kunne trekke på da jeg kom til Bergen og skulle skape mitt eget.
Ja, altså blant annet Leeds for eksempel, som jo nok har betydet meget.
Ja. Leeds var den viktigste. Jeg reiste til London med et stipendium for å arbeide med Firth, som jeg kjente. Mm. Og Leeds på det tidspunkt var svært lite kjent. Men det øyeblikk jeg traff ham ble jeg blendet av hans intellekt og hans voldsomme analytiske styrke. Han var jo en litt fjern person. På noen måter lignet han litt på min far. Med et stort intellekt og en slags skyhet som menneske. Men han betød kolossalt mye for meg. Og han var også så forbildelig i hvordan han la sånt arbeid i sin veiledning. Vi kunne komme til ham 30-40 sider vi hadde skrevet, og neste morgen så hadde han stor reaksjon, skrevet og tenkt, og en vitalitet som han la i sin veiledning, som var veldig stimulerende. Leeds hadde flere faser i sitt liv hvor han reorienterte seg, og jeg ville ha beundret ham enda mer hvis han hadde gjort enda mer av det.
Mm.
Det er mitt ideal at vi ikke skal forfølge våre ideer, men at vi skal la verden diktere langt mer enn de fleste akademikere gjør.
Mm. De fleste akademikere har også svært ved å forlade Elfenbenstårnet.
Ja.
Men det har du ikke. Du har sett en oppgave i å kunne formidle antropologien til almenheten.
Jeg har gjort det, og jeg har mange grunner til det. Altså, det er klart, hvis du tenker rent antropologisk på det, så er det viktig at et hvert akademisk fag har en omgivelse som er interessert for rekruttering, for støtte, for posisjon i det intellektuelle landskapet. Ganske tidlig i min karriere måtte jeg tjene noen penger ved å holde populære foredrag. Og så oppdaget jeg hvilken fantastisk trening det er for undervisning, selvsagt, men intellektuelt også. Hvis du er akademiker i ditt elfenbenstårn, så kan du på en måte by studentene hva som helst, og de har ikke noe valg, de er captive audience. Det øyeblikk du begir deg utenfor, så står du overfor publikum som kan reise seg og gå. Du må fange dem. Du må fange dem ved å være klar, ved å faktisk fortelle dem noe som de syns er interessant, og som de kan lære. Og den utfordringen har jeg hatt veldig glede av.
I dette andre programmet i serien Andres liv og vårt, snakker Fredrik Barth om samfunnsstyring og vold.
Ved å lære i dybden om andre samfunn og kulturer, så kan vi lære å skille mellom det som er iboende, menneskelig og felles, og det som bare virker nødvendig for oss fordi at vi er medlemmer av akkurat den kulturen som er vår. Nordmenn stort sett tenker seg vel at staten er en forutsetning for ordnet samfunnsliv, og at rettsvern er en forutsetning for frihet. Men mange mennesker lever i samfunn uten noen statsorganisasjon. Og de har en eller annen slags orden på sin tilværelse og opplever noe som de regner som frihet.
Det har skjedd en total forandring i mitt liv fra da jeg begynte, og det var denne lille loftsgjengen. Som en engelsk kollega sa, you could count them on a mutilated left hand. Og så til denne situasjonen nå, hvor du har kull på bortimot 1000 hvert år i Norge, som tar et grunnfag i antropologi, og som gjennomsyrer efter hvert norsk samfunn, med perspektiver som jeg tror er viktige og nyttige. Så jeg har alltid sett en nasjonal oppgave for å fremme dette faget.
Mange av de historiske begivenheter har funnet sted i Oslo. Er det ikke riktig?
Jo, det jo et sentrum for Norge, og det et sentrum i mitt liv. Men kanskje vi skal ta det i morgen, så kan jeg gi deg et bitte lite Norge i 5 minutter, og forklare hva bakgrunnen er. Yes, it's a small country, you know, and everything tends to focus on the capital, and so it's reflected here.
Frederick, when was Oslo University founded?
I guess 1810 or something like that. It was just a few years before Norway got its constitution and its separate identity. So it's been part of Norwegian history. Please, ever since we became a nation. So this is the place I choose, sort of, to give an idea of all of Norway and Norwegian history. Because here you see the four pillars of Norwegian society.
Yes, and what is it?
The first one, I guess, is Parliament. The second one is the university. The third one, the king's palace, and in the history of Norway, the fourth one, the national theater. Throughout the last century, this was as much a force of civil society as any other institution. Great authors fighting for liberty and mobilizing the people. So here you have the four basic units of Norwegian society. And Norwegian history has unfolded here, and my own personal history has been sort of involved. For example, well, when the German occupation came, they marched down this street and took over. And in the early 40s, the army closed off the university and arrested everybody, including my father. And then, in 1945, in May days like what we have now, it all opened up again. And again, this is where it all happened. The free forces came down Karl Johan, English and Norwegian, and the buses started coming after a day with the prisoners from the prison camps, all of them let loose here, and all of Oslo coming together and greeting them. And for major political occasions, also this is the center. The rector of the university, of course, welcomes the new group to the university. But I have also spoken from those steps when we made the Afghanistan committee. When the Russians invaded Afghanistan, we rallied the Norwegian people from those steps. So I have the sense, at least, of my personal history intermingling with Norway's history and me being a part of it. And it's all centered on this place, really.
Early in his career, Barth learned how to give popular presentations to the general public. He regards it as an excellent training in technical communication skills. He still enjoys doing public lectures, like this Sunday matinee in Oslo's Ethnographic Museum.
Ja, tusen takk. Ja, tusen takk for innledningen. Og for, til alle dere som har møtt opp på en så nydelig dag som dette. Jeg skal snakke i dag altså om en gruppe med nomader, saueholdende, sauebruk, februksholdende nomader i Sydpersia. En gruppe som vandrer gjennom hele året og hele livet fra lavlandsområder i syd, på en par hundre meter over havet, hvor de om vinteren, og opp gjennom vidunderlig landskap til høye fjellområder, hvor de om sommeren. Delvis drar de gjennom bebodde områder, og særlig i det midterste området, der det forholdsvis tett bebyggelse med landsbyer og jordbruk, hvor de må holde seg på kanten av jordbruket selvsagt, ellers så slipper dyrene inn på markene og ødelegger. Men de har lite kontakt med disse landsbyene. De to partene unngår hverandre i grunnen, og hvis det blir konflikt, hvis nomadenes flokker ødelegger noe, så gjøres ikke det opp direkte mellom bonden og nomaden. Nomadene er organisert i en stor stamme med en høvding, og høvdingen tar seg av slike saker. Likeledes i landsbyen har de da landsbylokale ansvarlige som bringer vittner og reiser krav hvis det nødvendig. Så jeg håper at også dette et lite bidrag i samme retning, og vi arbeider stadig politisk for å argumentere for den balansen som kan skapes mellom det dominerende jordbruksfolk og staten på den ene side, og de nomadiske stammene på den andre. Takk for oppmerksomheten.
The long-lasting link of the University of Bergen with the University of Khartoum dates back to 1964, when Fredrik Barth visited the Sudan for the first time. He spent some months fieldwork in Darfur, where his student Gunnar Holland visited him and shot this 8mm film.
Actually, when I went to Darfur, I thought that there would be some remnants, at least, of the old sultanate, and that I would be doing political anthropology there. But it turned out that there was very little, even memory, of the sultans left. So it was natural to turn to village economics, really. And there, the ideas that I'd had about entrepreneurship made me question the simplicity of the way anthropologists at that time spoke about spheres of exchange, because they saw only the exchange.
Yeah.
I felt that since people in economic matters are engaged in investment and production, as well as exchange, and saving, that the whole economic system should be seen from the perspective of spheres. And I sort of looked at the agency that was managing economy, household or personal economies, and what their options were, and discovered that the concept of spheres, of non-exchangeable things, could be used in this broader framework for describing the possible paths in the economic system.
Now, you said that one of the difficulties of working in Darfur was that there was a lot of drunkenness, but surely the beer drinking became part of your key data and was an aspect of the natural economy.
It was a very vital aspect of the economy, but that's why it was so prevalent. So, and in fact, I figured out that about a quarter or maybe even more of the total grain production of the area is converted into beer. So it's a major foodstuff, really. And that's how it's used. It is also a festive foodstuff. And so it is used in these labor mobilizations where people basically reciprocally help each other and are served beer as sort of payment, in quotes, for the labor they are exchanging.
What's your view on anthropologists in development?
I think that it should be self-evident to everyone that they are necessary, that they are important, that an anthropological perspective seems to me the only social science perspective that can capture the fundamental purposes of these development projects.
But no pleasure in saying, look, my hands are clean.
No, that seems a very cheap kind of pleasure, that you withdraw from engagement in the world because otherwise you might get dirty. We simply have to do that. I don't see that people working in critical theory or other kinds of abstract theory really put the work into producing the kind of theory we need to engage the world. We must think of what kind of theory which makes us capable of forming policy which is humanely defensible.
Barth first visited the Bactaman people of central New Guinea in 1968 and returned again in 1982. In all, he carried out 16 months of fieldwork among them. This experience led him to a skeptical critique of structuralist approaches to thought systems as containers of uniform meanings. Barth concentrated on the series of initiation rituals among Bactaman males, and he approached them as kinds of unevenly distributed secret knowledge. This exploded the idea of a shared cultural system.
My whole procedure has always been to look to the empirical material and then build my theory from that. So though I wanted to relate to their discourse, I yet wanted to do it from my own stuff. So I went to New Guinea, completely new place for me. And I came to the Bactaman, I found them. They had just been contacted. And I ran into this extraordinarily complex initiation system, which forced me to conceptualize the meaning of symbols differently. Because here is a system where boys are brought into, given some knowledge, lack other knowledge. There isn't the sharing of knowledge. And it's further elaborated as a system of secrecy, where the whole point, the value of the information is that it's secret. And so people are constantly interacting over symbols with different knowledge with which to read it. And the boys are led in stages over about 20 years. And you see here, it culminates with the fully initiated man who knows it all, a sort of a Renaissance genius who knows the real secrets. But there are 11 such men among the Bactaman. There are 185 people. You can't say that the real culture is what these few men hold. It must be the whole sweep. So they are all different in their views. My interest, though, was on analyzing the ritual language that was being composed. That was sort of the basis for my study. And that happens inside of these temples. As you see, they are closed buildings, and normally the door is closed. But inside, there is the sacra, the skull, and much of it takes the form of an ancestral worship, where initiation makes you a member of the congregation. The idea of the diversity within even such a small-scale society, of course, is represented by the woman, who is outside of the whole secret cult and a full member of society on her terms. And so I recognized the way in which we construct our different worlds and different experiences through something you could call systems of knowledge, yes. And that is That's a design a theme that I've tried to pursue and develop further in my subsequent fieldwork.
In 1974 and 75, Barth carried out 8 months of fieldwork in the town of Sohar, Oman. He accompanied his wife, Unni Wikan, herself an experienced Norwegian anthropologist who had a command of the field language Arabic. She concentrated on gender and he on cultural diversity.
There is a great diversity in the town of Sohar. There are people who speak different languages and are different ethnic groups, but there are all these other dimensions of diversity, like between real townspeople and the Bedouin along the fringe of the town, between people of different religions, different occupations that are very different skills and lifestyles, man and woman in a sex, gender segregated society, the descendants of recently freed slaves versus ordinary people versus high class people, all kinds of crossing diversities. And that fascinated me and forced me to think, I think, along new lines about cultural pluralism.
What difference does it make to have the other person present doing the fieldwork?
Well, first of all, it was a teaching experience for me, because I had always done fieldwork alone, and indeed Unni had. And here we were together, and we were seeing how the other was operating in the field. And I was very taken aback by the difference, the extent of difference. Of course, every person is a distinctive person and has her or his style. But I would have sworn that it was not possible to practice fieldwork the way Unni did. And yet I saw that it was highly successful. I am very careful, very tolerant, very unassertive in my demeanor in the field. Unni is all alive and full of opinions. And I was sure that this would make trouble.
Yes, I think Freddie came with the old-fashioned, if you will allow, conventional idea of participant observation, mm-hmm. that you try to go native as much as possible. I mean, it's not, mm-hmm. I'm not meaning it derogatorily, but that at the time, that's what many people thought and you also did. Mm-hmm. So you tried to be like a native, which meant, yes, as you said, being very unassuming, accommodating, tolerant, and nice, which you were, and everybody liked you. But on the other hand, as you say, you were, I remember he was entirely shocked by my way of being. And I, of course, knew that it worked, or at least it worked some places, because I had extensive fieldwork experience in Cairo, and it had worked well. But yes, I think when in some ways, at least some people like me better than him, as he says, it's because they knew where they had me.
In 1983, Barth and Unni Wikan again carried out parallel field research in Bali. Both New Guinea and Oman had in their ways been physically difficult. Bali was both beautiful and temperate. It had already been made famous in anthropology by the work of Margaret Mead and Gregory Bateson, and later by Clifford Geertz and numerous others.
Everyone who's worked in Bali has talked about the problem of variation. What's distinctive in your approach?
Precisely as you say, they've talked about it, they've mentioned it, but they haven't confronted it. But the way I handled it was by following up insights that I'd been developing during our visit to New Guinea, our revisit. I saw regional variation there. And from before, I knew about the variation in the positioning of people there. I had developed that in Sohar with cultural pluralism besides ethnicity. And now here in northern Bali, I saw vast cultural pluralism without ethnicity. All the other components, sort of. And I wanted to address that.
Now, Unni Wikan, you took a very different tack in your Balinese project. I mean, but it's also a tack that is in a sense, an argument with Geertz on emotion in Bali.
Oh, absolutely, yes, on emotion and on the construction of personhood. Really, it's an argument with him about how do you proceed if you want to understand real human beings? And you should be aware that I went to Bali only to build on Geertz. I didn't go there to have an argument with him. And it came as a total shock to me when I came to Bali that if I applied his models of conduct and personhood in Bali to the people I knew, then it just didn't make sense.
Can you give an example of how it didn't make sense?
Yes, Geertz portrays the Balinese as depersonalized, as playing very stereotypical roles, as having really no notion of the self. He says that the Balinese people's notion of the self resides in kind of the masks they wear, the roles that they play. Well, I didn't meet such human beings. I met individuals who cared, who had concerns in life, who had ups and downs and compelling concerns, and who both met each other and they met me. They were accessible.
Frederick, by calling your monograph Balinese Worlds, plural, you're signaling a continual commitment to the idea of pluralism, and also you talk about realism close to experience. Is it the case you see yourself as intellectually converging with Unni Wikan on this issue?
Perhaps, yes, on this issue, certainly, that I have developed a stronger understanding commitment to the idea that meaning for people must be experiential. The other kinds of meanings that we can put into the analysis of our cultural materials are partial and probably often wrong unless we are able to transform them through the experience of those who are living this. And so it's by working beside Unni and seeing what she is learning that I have been converging in that direction. Yes.
In recent years, Barth and Wikan have visited Bhutan as consultants for various development agencies. Frederik Barth continues to be fascinated by the construction, representation, and social organization of knowledge, a continuation of earlier interests from his Bactaman and Bali fieldwork.
I move among reincarnate Buddhas who have centuries of memory from many lives. I move among monks in the monastic system who have a very high, refined degree of intellectual training. And I move among people who are of various kinds, but some of them, many of them, peasant, illiterate. And of course, there is the modern elite and their forms of knowledge. This is a different kind of diversity again from what I had seen in Bali, and I'm fascinated by it. My idea is, it started growing in my work in New Guinea already, the sense that a very important modality of culture is the knowledge that is created and used in a form of life. And so I have been focusing more and more on knowledge and the anthropology of knowledge.
Frederick, you've done more field work than any two other anthropologists put together. And what have you got to pass on to new field workers as two or three hints from all this experience?
Two or three hints?
Yeah.
Okay. To be intellectually humble. Keep looking at their concerns and their understanding of those concerns, their position in organizations, their ideas about how things are. But we should recognize the nature of our privilege and try not to utilize it in our human relations. You should be open to what is there. Watch and wonder. You want to be surprised, and you want to let yourself be surprised, and you want to put yourself where you can be as surprised as possible. And then you wonder What's it like? How does it hang together? What is the picture? You must build on what is there and not what you have brought.